politics with humor, to bring insight to the people. On many a lonely night, I've listened to Jim Hightower, and a smile comes on my face. Every time I listen to him speak, he gives me a new insight. He had the patience to work under George Bush in Texas. He's born and raised in Texas, and he's the man in the cowboy hat. Let's give it up for Jim Hightower.
Thank you, Ty. Thanks so much. How terrific to be here, and I've come all the way from Austin, Texas, not to lecture to you, but simply to thank you for being out here, you democracy fighters, daring to stand up for we the people, and we need a people's declaration of independence from corporate power in America, and that to me is what you represent, what you are doing. It's just tremendous. And by the way, you know, I don't have to come all the way to Washington, D.C. to find Occupy. We've got it in Dallas. We've got it in Houston. We've got it in Austin, of course. We've got it in San Antonio, all the way down to the tip of Texas, in McAllen, Texas. They had one of the earliest of the Occupy movements after the Wall Street event there. So my basic message to you is thank you. Thank you for what you're doing, for taking on the bankers and the bosses, the big shots, the bastards and the bullshitters who think that they can just run over us and we won't do anything about it. And you represent millions and millions of people who are not going to come camp out in tents like you hardy folks are, but support what you're doing. And you've seen the polls as well as I have of the support that you've got all across the country. Of course, you've got the naysayers as well. We've got Herman Cain, the Godfather man, who says that you are anti-American for protesting banks. We've got Mitt Romney, who says that it's dangerous, this class warfare. You've got Mike Bloomberg up in New York, who says that you're just simply misguided. Well, they are as confused as goats on AstroTurf when it comes to understanding what America is all about, because you are America, the mutts and mavericks who built this country. It was not the great men who built America. It was ordinary folks who dared to stand up. And all the way back to Thomas Paine and Shays' Rebellion and right on through Sojourner Truth and Frederick Douglass and the populists and the Wobblies and the labor movement and then into the people's movement, the environmental movement, the women's movement, they just right on down to what we have here, which is a tremendous democracy movement in the footsteps of all of those patriots from the early days onward. You know, they call you agitators, you know. But remember this. The agitator is the center post in the washing machine that gets the dirt out.
That's right.
That's a good thing.
All right.
Agitation, after all, is what built America. Well, America needs you. And I come from Austin, Texas, but actually I come from South Austin, Texas. And we have a little bit of an attitudinal difference over there on the south side. We've got a kind of community saying, which is, we're all here because we're not all there. And I think we're all here today. We're all here for the foreseeable future because the economic and political powers in our country are not all there in terms of understanding what America is about, not understanding those fundamental founding values of economic fairness, social justice, equal opportunity for all people. That's what America represents, and that's what you're standing for. And more importantly, you're doing something about it. That's the inspiring thing. People have had this in their heart and in their guts and their head for a long time, but they didn't know what to do. Well, finally, a few people stood up in New York City, and suddenly all of America stood up because you're leading the way for this. I was up in Vermont a year or so ago with our friend Bernie Sanders up there doing some politicking, and this guy came up wearing a political button. It said, wearing a button is not enough. We cannot be a nation of button wearers. We've got to do something. And that is, again, what has built America over the years. So you're taking it to the streets, not only speaking truth to power, but I think more importantly, speaking truth about power. Because people need to rally around that, and they will, and already are, as a result of what you're doing. So just keep pushing. In March, I was up in Madison, Wisconsin at that huge rally. We had about 150,000 people and 20-degree weather out there. And it was a tremendous stand that people of Wisconsin took there. There was not only workers, but there was a tractorcade of farmers going completely around the Capitol Square there in Madison. Young people, old people, there were environmentalists, teachers and students. It was a tremendous thing. And I looked out as I was speaking, and a woman over on my left had a handmade sign, and it said, "You screw us, we reproduce." And that is what's happened. This is the reproduction of what kicked off there in Madison. Well, don't worry about what the leaders say, because you are the leaders, and that is exactly how it is supposed to be. I'll leave you with this thought. It's from the great rocker Patti Smith, that great song, "People have the power to dream, to rule, to wrestle the world from fools," and that's exactly what you're involved in. Thank you for what you're doing. A joy to be here.
Now, Jim is also an author, so look up his books if you haven't read them already. They're excellent and very funny. I think we should have some questions from people about to Jim about his actions that he does. Does anybody have any questions or comments?
I have a question. Simply, I've been cut off from the news for 2 weeks, so I really want to know what the support is like out there.
Yeah, what are those bulls?
Yeah, the question you're getting.
What he said, he's been cut off from the news for a couple of weeks, so what's important about what's going on out there? What's important is this right here. There's nothing more important than this right here. And it's in how many cities now, do they say? Yeah. I mean, it's just everywhere. And again, the polling is phenomenal. The poll just a couple of weeks ago said that there are 54% of the American people agreed with the people who are in the streets about what they are saying. Now that's phenomenal for Americans to say we're on the side in this early day of this movement. And this is the early days of it. This is just the beginning. I'll tell you another thing that's out there, and that is the powers that be are scoffing at you now, saying, yeah, but as soon as the cold weather comes, they're going to fold up those tents and get out of here. And so they're counting on that. They're counting on you folding. That is a big mistake on their part. I mean, if ignorance is bliss, they must be ecstatic, because ordinary folks are not going to give up. They never have in America. And by the way, that is the strength here. And that you have to understand. Have to hold within you that notion that you are in those footsteps of a march of democracy. We haven't gotten there. In fact, that first election that elected George Washington, only 4% of the people were even eligible to vote. You couldn't vote if you were a woman. You couldn't vote if you were Native American, if you were African American. You couldn't vote if you didn't own land. You had to own land to be able to vote. So we've come a long ways, and we've come a long ways only because people like you dared to push to democratize those documents, so the Declaration and the Constitution and the Bill of Rights. So that's what you're a part of. And just as democracy moves forward, it falls back, too. And that's what's been happening in the last 20, 30 years in this country. The powers that be have decided that they can run roughshod over the powers that ought to be, the ordinary workaday folks.
I'm not sure you can answer this, but put it on the table. Some years ago, we had, I hate to say it, maybe it was the Vietnam War, but it doesn't matter. Shareholders movement to get shareholders to go to the bank with the board, et cetera, as a maneuver, as a project, because, you know, we've got to get to the next step. So I'm asking, when will the shareholders stand?
She's asking about back in the Vietnam War protest days, which I was in that too. Civil rights in Vietnam pretty much got me into the progressive movement back in the 1960s. That in that period, shareholders finally got active and began to push from within the corporations to try to change the war policies at that time, and whether that is a tactic that we can pursue today. We can ask for it. It's going to be a long time coming, I think. More effective is what y'all are doing, and around the country is the Move Your Money movement, to go into the banks and take them out, put it into a credit union if you got any money, put it into a community bank, put it into a co-op bank or a labor bank. We've got all of those you know, you don't have to support the system with your money. You can support the counters to it, including cooperative movement. There's a fabulous cooperative movement in America, and that's where I think we need to be looking to build the alternative to the corporate economy, is to try to expand this co-op movement. 73,000 co-ops already in America. In fact, I've joined the first ever cooperative worker-managed brew pub in America.
Okay. Which,
you got to lubricate the movement, right?
Ah.
Yes, sir.
Going anywhere in the cold weather, you should.
You hit Scott Walker?
Yes. Our big question that we feel needs to be addressed is, apart from the occupation efforts that are going on around the world, what is being done to directly address, right here from Washington, Alec's influence and to spearhead the cutting off of that hydrogen head?
He's asking about Alec. The American Legislative Exchange Council. That sounds like an innocuous thing. Let's exchange legislative ideas. How
money
democratic.
For legislation.
And of course, it's a Koch brother funded, not solely, but the Koch brothers are in it, and the DeVosses and the Coors and the Walmart heirs and et cetera are behind this thing called ALEC. And what they do is run around the country, and they have 4 to 10 meetings in capitals, regional areas, bringing legislators, state legislators in, and handing them legislation for them to carry. That's where all the anti-immigration legislation has come from, out of this think tank group that is out there. That's where so many of the whole effort of Scott Walker, of John Kasich in Ohio, of Christie up here in New Jersey, of that guy, Snyder, I guess it is, in Michigan, Scott down here in Florida, Rick Perry in my state. There's a guy who puts the goober in gubernatorial, by the way. So pay attention to him. As our friend Molly Ivins, in one of her last columns of the Bush administration, she said, when I tell y'all that someone from Texas should not be elected president, pay attention. So, Molly's not here anymore, so I'll be her surrogate. Pay attention to this guy. But that there is an effort by progressive groups generally to out ALEC, and including confronting them in their meetings, those secret meetings that they hold. And there's a group, in fact, based in a part of it's based in Madison. Mary Batari heads it, and I can't think of the name of it at the moment, but that is focused squarely on ALEC. And John Nichols, a great writer with Nation Magazine, he's been doing a lot of coverage on it. Nation Magazine has had a whole series on it, so people are on to it, and just exposing them. I mean, the Koch brothers operated for 30 years in secret, and now suddenly they're exposed, and they're horrified. They feel very defensive, and they're saying, well, we're just operating, this is just democratic participation, you know, with our billions of dollars, you know, nonsense. Yes? Yes, very good question. He asked, is ALEC like a nonprofit? Do the corporation get a deduction for contributing to it? Yes, they do. They get a tax deduction. Yeah, they're supposed to be non-political. And there is a lawsuit being filed, or probably already filed, on that very topic, that they have violated their non-profit status. Right, right. C3, and they've got a C4 too, but nonetheless. Yes?
Where do you see this whole thing going? I mean, what do we need to do to make this sustainable over the long term?
Where do I see this thing being y'all, going? How do we sustain it for the long haul? Well, you've got to tell me that. That's not. It's really not my role. I'm just writing now. I have a monthly newsletter called the Hightower Lowdown that goes to about 100-something thousand people. And I'm doing this issue, this next month's issue, just completing. I was just up at a coffee shop a while ago, finishing up pieces of it on this movement. But I'm saying that right now, because, you know, you're being condemned even by progressives, they say, well, they don't have an agenda. Well, hello, the name Wall Street is in the movement's name. seems like an agenda to me. And I'm making the point that right now, protest is
the issue. I mean, just being there is a big part of the battle, and that's why people are rallying around you. And they say, well, you've got to come up with specifics. You've got to have your list of demands and your manifesto. Well, you know, we did the American Revolution. It was years before we got a manifesto and a clear list of demands. You can't ask people to come together and initially and then rally around that. It would split the movement apart if you tried to do that. The same with that Vietnam War protest. It was a long time before we ever came up with a specific list of legislation that we wanted passed. So don't worry about that at this point.
Just
the Port Huron statement, Tom Hayden and others working on that. That's very good. See, we do have historic documents, but just standing against corporate power, people get that. Maybe the Wall Streeters don't, but everybody, just ordinary folks, understand, because, you know, as I've written, this is not about ideologies. This is about realities that people are experiencing. You know, the vast majority of American people are being knocked down and then stomped on or held down if you're poor, and people get it. So you're just doing the right thing right now, and you will evolve. You come up with what it is, what your steps are. Some will be wrong. Many will be right, and you'll figure it out. It's an organic movement. You know, and as my friend John Drumbrough, he's a pioneer in the organic movement, puts it, he says, those who say it can't be done should not interrupt those who are doing it. And that would be you.
Excuse me, everybody, if I'm stating the obvious. I talked about this before. I apologize. One thing I think is important, and I've been trying to do it, is when people come and visit us, is to tell them they don't have to sleep here, they don't have to camp here. Come any evening.
Beautiful. That's exactly right. Everybody get that?
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah.
Good. Yep. That's very, very good point. And I, by the way, I'm glad you said that, because I will now put that in my lowdown as part of the conclusion. All right. Let's take another one. Yes, ma'am. Well, that's obviously that's part of what you want. She's asking, what do we do about voter disenfranchisement, which is just rampant across the country? By the way, Alec has been a promoter of this. The voter ID thing came out of Alec. The other efforts to say that college students cannot vote in the community where their college is, they have to vote back home, which disenfranchises them. And all kinds of other voter disenfranchisement efforts have come out of Alec. So what do we do about that? Well, what people are doing, we're challenging it, and not as effectively as we need to, but we have to be in the face of that power. There's all kinds of voter disenfranchisement. It's not just the voter ID, but the intimidation at the polls, particularly in low-income communities and communities of immigrants, where they just make you feel threatened to go in. It's, you know, it's not like a lot of poor people are coming out of Central America or Mexico to come up here and vote for somebody in particular. This is not an actual problem in America. This is just an act of intimidation, the voter ID thing. So we have to monitor the polls, but also we have to go head-to-head with them on this legislation, and there is a movement to do that. AFL-CIO in particular is leading the charge on that one. The question is whether we're looking at the German experience after World War I, with all the economic distress at that time, and then led to Hitler, people swayed by certain nationalistic rhetoric that led to extremists, and could that happen here? Well, of course it could. But that's the importance of your democratic, little democratic efforts that you're making. And what I've seen across the country is you're doing a remarkable job of keeping this clean, ideologically, politically, of making clear what you stand for and what you don't stand for. So it really is up to you, but it's also up to then people like me, the more traditional progressive forces in the country, to make clear what you are and what you're not. That's why I'm doing this in the lowdown, but other publications are as well. You know, I launched with Katrina Vandenhoevel at Nation Magazine and Jay Harris out of Mother Jones Magazine. We launched this thing. We're going to have a focus on it next week, of next 2 or 3 weeks, actually, of trying to get the progressive media to come together to focus on corporate power, particularly corporate money in politics, and specifically Citizen United to repeal that decision. So we've got all kinds of community radio stations. We've got Newsweekly, alternative Newsweeklies. We've got all the major magazines, My Lowdown and other efforts, Laura Flanders and Tom Hartman and other good people like that. We're talking to the MSNBC hosts as well to focus on that. We're asking the Progressive Caucus to use their videos that week and their floor speeches to talk about this issue. So that's where we have to keep the focus, on that corporate power, because what Germany became was a corporate government under Hitler, and we do have to fight that. But if you had not stood up, we were drifting in that direction anyway. You know, it's not like we have not had extremists in office. We have extremists who have given us 2 wars, who have given us a jobless recovery in America, who has said that there's a new normal of people being jobless and for a long time, a long-term unemployment, not getting, slashing the social network and all of that stuff. So, you know, that's extreme in its own right. And they say that you are anti-capitalist. Well, you know, I are a capitalist. You know, I've got a small business. But I want to make a living, not a killing. You know? Uh-huh. And the anti-capitalists are Wall Streeters who don't believe in capitalism. So, you know, you're doing the right thing. So just keep pushing. Take another one or two from the
group.
Yes, the question is about corporate personhood. Is there a movement to repeal that, which comes out of ridiculous Supreme Court interpretations over the years, particularly the Citizen United? Yes, there are 2 efforts. One is movetoamend.org, and they've got a grassroots organization all across the country for a constitutional amendment that would directly repeal the idea of corporate personhood. There's another one, freespeechforpeople.org, that would repeal the Citizen United decision. Both of these efforts have strong grassroots organizations, outreach. So they've got videos and training material to help people move. And this effort that we're doing in the next couple of weeks is to try to raise American consciousness about corporate money and politics, and then connect them to these movements so they can do something about it right where they live. And by the way, you don't have to wait on the constitutional amendment. You can pass public financing of your local elections. You don't even have to wait on your state. You can pass anti-corporate personhood ordinances in cities. Various cities have done that. There's one on the ballot this fall in Boulder, Colorado, for example. So there are a number of steps that you can take yourself, not waiting on anybody else to do it for you. Yes. Questions about Obama's jobs plan at a time when so many jobs are being sent overseas. Well, I'm certainly for Obama's jobs plan. I wish it was more sweeping than it is, more Rooseveltian, dare I say, than it is. We need the WPA back in America. We need the CCC. We need the Writers and Artists Project. We need to put people to work, not keep subsidizing corporations in the hope that they might somehow or other have a tinkle-down effect that will come to us. But so it's not enough, it's not strong enough. But even that modest proposal has been, you know, kicked in the teeth by Johnny Boehner and little Eric Cantor and, you know, that crowd of Neanderthals up there. So. She's saying that today's New York Times has a poll saying that 63% say they don't have enough information to have an opinion about the Occupy movement. I've seen other polls that would deny that entirely, but all that means is you just got to keep pushing, you know, to keep pressing that message, because you are reaching people. The New York Times is not exactly doing its job, by the way, of informing people, so, you know, let's start with that. But this has always been the case of progressive movements. We've always had to fight the media. I know in Texas in the 1950s we had a political, progressive political movement of organizing, and they created the Texas Observer in 1954 because we could not get the established media to cover progressive issues or progressive candidates. Ralph Yarborough became U.S. Senator from Texas, great fighting populist. He would be in Dallas, there'd be 5,000 people there, and the next day there'd be nothing in the paper that he didn't exist, you know. And we had a slogan, the Dallas Morning News, if it happens in Dallas, it's news to us. So we've always had to fight that thing. But your own communication network, I mean, this thing came from social media. I mean, that's essentially, y'all did your own media, and that's what we continue to have to do, printing your Occupy papers and getting that word out. And I love the suggestion of get people to come here, openly inviting them, you know, in various ways. Go to churches here and say, please bring your congregation after Sunday services or Saturday services. Come down here and visit with us, and we'll have a bite of food or something or other, and have a good time. So that's what it's going to take. Again, it's a long time getting word out. And the American Revolution, you know, not even a third of the colonists at the time supported the Declaration of Independence. So, you know, you build, you start, and y'all have started with a big percentage of the American people. This is very rare in progressive movements to have this kind of support. Take another one or two. That's very true. And the outreach, by the way, you are reaching out, though, again, by the very theme of what you're saying, has such broad appeal, including Tea Party, very broad Tea Party appeal. Got to remember, the Tea Party came into existence, a spontaneous combustion, because of the Wall Street bailout. It didn't have anything to do with small government or Grover Norquist, you know, et cetera. It was ordinary folks who were just mad as hell about that bailout. For the first time in a long time, we had this thing shoved in our face about government power coordinating with corporate power to save the elites at the expense of everybody else. It was blatant. People saw it and they were mad about it. They went into the streets. Unfortunately, our side, the progressive side, didn't go into the streets with them because Obama was just coming into office, taking the oath of office up here. People were inspired. They thought, well, we got to stick with this instead of going to the streets. But Dick Armey, the running a Koch Brothers operation called Freedom Works, saw this opportunity out there of all these people, and he came to him and said, I can help you, because he brought Koch Brothers money. He brought Republican political operatives and experts. He brought organizers. And they took over the Tea Party movement. The Tea Party Manifesto was written by Dick Armey, not by any Tea Party people, written by, he's a corporate lobbyist, a former majority leader of the Republican Party up here. And that's why that movement has dwindled to almost nothing. There's about 18% of the people now say they can identify some way or another with the Tea Party. It has gone come apart, largely because they elected a bunch of nutballs who went up here and started trying to deregulate Wall Street and save big oil and do all the things that the rank and file were saying, what the hell is that about? That's not what I meant, you know. And so we do have an opportunity to reach out to those folks, and I would say do it directly. Find some of the more grassroots leaders within it and some of the publications within it. I would also say reach out to the churches. You know, we don't do enough of that. I'm including evangelicals in that. Who actually, you know, most people in those evangelical churches are working people and poor people. Bankers don't go to evangelical churches. I don't know if they go to church at all, but Church of Mammon, I guess. But nonetheless, there's a lot of opportunity to reach out. But I think you're going to do that. You already have the idea in your head, and just spread that. You know, it's, again, this movement came out of just nothing. And already is organized at a national level in a phenomenal network. But it's going to take a while to get to all these things. But as long as you've got it in your head and it's part of the strategy, I think you're going to be all right. Let's take one more.
I think most of us here agree that the system is absolutely broken. And we are cautious that when we hear things like, well, Dick Gregory was here, and he said, President Obama supports you. And that's just crap. If he supported us, he wouldn't be, you know, implementing the policies. So I think we're very cautious that we don't want to be co-opted by the so-called, you know, the Democratic Party. But the problem is that we are so entrenched with the two-party system, how can we really get out of this, you know, this structure?
Yeah, yes, you heard it. The general concern about we don't want to be co-opted by the Democratic Party. She said, Dick Gregory came and said, Obama supports you. Well, I saw this sign over here said, come have a beer with us. You know, that would show some support, you know, right there. He never went to Madison, Wisconsin. He hadn't gone to Ohio to protest things. So he doesn't support us. That doesn't mean he's the enemy, but it means that we got to know what he is. He is not the Democratic Party. The Democratic Party is those who are grassroots people in the Democratic Party, but also the same for the Green Party and the other movements that are out
there.
Yeah, we don't have to just be wedded to Green Party. There you go.
we're not beholden to the corporate paymaster.
Yeah, exactly. So, but also, you got to figure out your own politics. You know, the presidential election probably is not something that is going to take a whole lot of your time. You ought to focus on state legislative elections and city council elections and places where you can make a difference right now and begin to make those changes where you can then have people who develop progressive policies and they begin to move up. The populist movement after the Civil War, the great populist movement that swept the country, it wasn't just in the South. It went from New York to California. It was a genuine people's movement, but it was 10 to 12 years before they went into politics. It was essentially an economic movement and social and a cultural movement. And they reached people that way that they could not have reached just through politics. So I would ask you to look at a strategic view of politics, of where you can fit without being co-opted by any of it, and where you can make changes in that political arena without being co-opted or diverting your energy, diverting your time. Keep organizing people. That's the first thing you want to do. And then focus them on certain changes and certain issues that you will choose, including getting money out of politics and that sort of thing.
Hey, Jim, can you tell us where we can read about you, hear you?
Where you can connect with me is on my website, jimhightower.com. That's pretty simple. Jim Hightower. That would be H-I-G-H-T-O-W-E-R. Tori Alto. JimHightower.com. And there it is. I do daily radio commentaries. You can hear them on the net. I do the newsletter that I mention each month. I do a weekly newspaper column. I do a lot of speechifying and just generally run my mouth and try to eke out a living on it. But thank you all. Thank you for helping me. I'm very proud to be with you.
Jim Hightower. Always amazing. So, are you just... Jim's going to stick around for a little bit. You can talk to him, I guess, and...
We also got an announcement from Kevin about how if you want to help in our cause, if you're out there, he can tell you how you can help supply us with the needed things we need.
Well, the first thing we need is people. So please tell your friends and neighbors and family to come down here. We need people first. And you should know that we are starting to get threatened by the police. We've been lucky to be out here, unlike in New York, without that kind of pressure. And the police are relatively friendly to us. They know they're part of 99%. So they're telling us they're getting pressure from above to close us down. And so we expect that may happen in the next week or two, and we're trying to reach out to all our friends in churches and unions and universities to make sure that they're on a rapid response list so they can be told when we need them here, because what will stop that will be thousands of people being here. So at our information table, you can sign up to be on that list, and if you go to our website at October2011.org, you can see what we're doing, and we're doing a lot. I mean, we have been focused very heavily on the Citibank for the last couple of days. We shut down one on Thursday. We did another action against one on Friday, and you can see the videos of those two actions on the website. We're always having less classes out here and discussions you can be part of. Next week, we're going to start focusing on the...